In contrast, in paravirtualized systems, the operating system knows that it's executing in a virtualized environment. Because of this, there is no longer a strict requirement for the guest OS to use contiguous physical memory that starts at zero. And the guest OS can explicitly register the page tables that it uses with the hypervisor, so there is no need for maintaining dual page tables, one at the guest and then another shadow one at the hypervisor level. Now, the guest still doesn't have write permissions to this page table that's now used by the hardware, because otherwise the guest potentially can establish any mapping and corrupt other VMs that are running on the same system. So because of that, every update to the page table would cause a trap and pass control to the hypervisor, but because the guest is paravirtualized, then we can modify the guest and do tricks like batch a number of page table updates and then issue a single hypercall in this case to tell the hypervisor to install all of these mappings. So this can amortize the cost of the exit across multiple operations. There can be other optimizations that are useful. For instance, optimizations related to how the memory is managed so that it's more friendly to execution in a virtualized environment, or so that it's more cooperative with respect to other VMs in the system and other things. One thing to note that the two mechanisms that I described with respect to memory virtualization for both full as well as paravirtualized VMs have substantially been improved given advances in the new hardware architecture. So some of these overheads have completely been eliminated or at least substantially reduced if we take a look at what's happening at the newer generation of x86 platforms. And we will talk about that shortly in this lesson.